Okay, so good evening, everybody. So in that class or talk, I would like to discuss neuromorphic physics, which is a physics of devices, materials, and systems inspired from the brain. And so, hello. I would like to try to give you an overview of this field, but most of all, I would like you to, in the end of this course, I hope like it as much as I do and be as enthused as I am. And so, of course, this course is not for me. It's really for you that I made it. And so it's the first time I give it. So, I mean, it's not supposed to be boring or you are supposed to understand everything. So if something is not clear, just, you know, raise your hand or let's try to make it interactive. And please help me because it's a long course. So, okay. So let's see. So, yeah, hello. So why should we take inspiration from the brain? That's the first question, maybe in this course. So as you know, the brain is a very beautiful computing system, but it's totally different from our computers. So typically, as you know, computers are extremely good at high precision computing. I mean, they make beautiful mathematical operations that can take the square root of very high numbers in microseconds, and our brains are very bad at this kind of calculations. But on the other hand, our brains are very good at other types of computing. For example, we are extremely fast and efficient at pattern recognition. We can recognize someone we know in a crowd, even if the face is half hidden. We are extremely good at planning and prediction, these things computers don't know very well how to do. We can do synthesis of a lot of data. We can perform very well symbolic reasoning. And also something that we have that is very important that computers don't have yet is some kind of common sense, right? So, okay. And so it's very nice to try to take inspiration of the brain to build computing systems that would be more complementary to the ones that we have now and have more functionalities of the brain to, because all these qualities of the brain are extremely useful, in particular to classify huge amounts of data and to make some predictions on this data. And so what is also very exciting is that the brain is totally different from our computing systems in two ways. First, from the algorithm point of view, and then also from the physical implementation point of view. So, hello. In terms of algorithms, maybe in I will talk later on about neural networks, but maybe in a very, very general way, I think that not speaking about neural network algorithms, but there are two main differences between our computers and our brains. For example, a PowerPoint is a program that is totally tailored by human beings, and everything is totally predicted. There is nothing fuzzy here. Whereas our brains can learn. I think this is the big difference. And so from this algorithm point of view, this is a big main difference. And also, this is where, I mean, from the algorithm point of view, these brain algorithms have, from the very beginning, inspired physicists. And physicists have contributed to their development. And you may know that machine learning, the field of machine learning, is extremely linked to statistical physics. Okay, so this is, from a theory point of view, is very well known. But there are other phenomena in the brain that have been observed in neuroscience and that have completely fascinated physicists from solid-state system and active matter. So for example, it has been shown or observed that the brain performs energy or entropy minimization. In the brain, there are observations of phase transitions and criticality. There are also observations of self-oscillations. Neurons self-oscillate. Assemblies of neurons seem to be able to have chaotic behavior or even to be able to synchronize together. There is a lot of indication that all the devices in the brain are highly stochastic. And so these observations are a very strong source of inspiration for physicists. And so many people in neuroscience come from physics, but also physicists have tried to develop models of computations based on these observations. And so they have proposed algorithms that use physics for computing. So for example, you may have heard about Hopfield networks or Boltzmann machines. They are all inspired from physical phenomena. They are initially based on spin systems, but they are not the only algorithms that are inspired from physical phenomena in the brain. Also, a lot of algorithms are using attractors for computing and nonlinear dynamics. Okay, but this is really from a kind of theory point of view. Today, in this course, I would like to concentrate on the link between these algorithms and the implementation of the brain. Because the brain is different from the computer, not only from algorithm point of view, but also from the implementation. Everything is different, yeah.
I was wondering, you mentioned these phase transitions in the brain. Could you elaborate a bit more on what kind of, where is this observed?
Yes, so when you look at assemblies of neurons, and you look at the, for example, assemblies of neurons have some activity, okay? And what you can see is that this activity propagates, and there are some avalanches that propagate, so spiking, avalanche of spiking neurons, and so you can plot the size of these avalanches as a function of their occurrence, you know, and you find all these exponential behavior that is very, that is a signature of critical systems. And also, many algorithms, you know, when they start to compute neural networks, it seems that when they start to learn and converge to a solution, it corresponds to some kind of phase transition. Okay, so this is an observation. It's not yet known how to use that for computing, but it's. I think really people are trying to think about that. So the brain is completely different from our computers. So as you know, our computers are made of. They are made of memory blocks and transistors, but in the brain you have neurons and synapses. In our computers, everything is binary coded. We use zeros and ones. In the brain, it seems like analog and binary coding are used. So for example, synapses are some kind of a valve for the information. And it seems that they convey information in an analog way. It's not just a switch. Huh? It can regulate with an analog behavior. But at the same time, you see information flows through synapses to the neurons that integrate this information and then emit, when they reach a threshold, they are going to emit a spike. And then it's transformed in some kind of binary coding, right? Because it's a spike or not a spike. So you have this kind of hybrid analog and binary coding. In our computers, everything is high precision. We try to avoid noise as much as possible. Noise is a big problem. It's going to generate errors. If you have a faulty transistor in a computer, it can ruin the whole processor. So noise is not tolerated. And so, in fact, in a way, it takes a lot of energy to eliminate this noise from electronic circuits. Whereas, on the contrary, in the brain, all the components seem to be highly stochastic. And we will discuss that later. It looks like the brain is working at the thermal limit in order to reduce its energy consumption. In our computers, there is a single clock. Everybody is going to obey that clock, and transistors are going to make their switch at the same time, and it's like there is a general ruling the army. In the brain, everything is is controlled by nothing, so it's a kind of communist system where all the entities inside seem to coordinate each other and perform some computation. And every neuron has its own clock, in a way its own clock, so it has internal dynamics. So the time is defined by the ensemble dynamics of the brain. In computers, what is very nice, of course, is that you can build them, make small blocks and then a hierarchy. So it's very useful when we want to design systems. In the brain, we don't know that. Well, maybe it's like that, but we have no idea. But it really seems like everything is correlated and that it's difficult. It looks like it has some emergent behavior, that it's difficult to separate. To know by looking the behavior of individual elements to guess the final dynamics. And then, of course, our computers have only a very limited reconfigurability. I mean, the memory part reconfigures, but the circuit itself is staying the same. Whereas in the brain, the memory is so distributed and in fact is created and disappears, is completely plastic. So the circuit of the brain completely changed. You would not recognize the circuit years after. You know, when you are a child and then you grow, the circuit inside really changed completely. And they change as you learn and acquire more information. Okay. So then, knowing that, if we want to try to build devices that take inspiration of this implementation and algorithm of the brain, why then would be why are physics and material science really important for neuromorphic computing? And so the answer is simple. It's because our current electronics is not going to be enough to achieve to implement these chips very efficiently. As you know, today artificial intelligence is really based on algorithms that are called neural networks. They are often represented in that way here. So you have the neurons are the circles and the arrows are the synapses. And so these algorithms are really inspired from neural networks in the brain. I mean, this architecture is taken from neural network in the brain. But then behavior and the way the information flows in this system is written in some lines of code. So, and then this is binarized, and this is a series of zeros and ones that are injected in our processors. And in that process, the physical layout of the neural network completely disappears, right? And so, a lot of the progress of neural networks recently is due to the fact that there's been new hardware that have been able to accelerate this process, like graphical cards, TPUs of FPGAs. But still, now this hardware is going to come to their limitation. And why is that, in fact? It's because in all these processors, it can be your CPUs or GPUs or the novel devices developed by Google that are called tensor processors. In all these devices, even if they are more and more efficient, still they have the same architecture where you have the memory that is completely separated from the logic part. And so even if they try to bring them more and more close together, there is still this separation. And even if the separation is they are trying to make it closer and closer, it's still physically separated. And it's a big problem for neural networks, because neural networks are like some huge fit functions. You have a lot of parameters, and these parameters, you need to change them all the time because the neural network needs to learn. And these parameters, of course, they are in the memory. So you need to go to the memory, fetch all these huge number of parameters, bring them to the logic part, the processing part, where you make a complicated transformation, and then you need to bring them back to the memory, and you need to do that all the time. And this is a waste of time. So this completely slows neural network today, and it's a huge waste of energy. A huge waste of energy. It consumes a lot of power. And so for this reason, neural networks today cannot really, when they are doing really impressive tasks, important tasks, they do not work in real time. They cannot perform, they cannot learn as the information comes. Learning is very slow and takes a lot of time. And also is done on clusters of GPUs that consume a huge amount of energy. And in fact, in the brain is a neural network, and the organization is completely different. So you have the neurons that you can see as doing the processing, and you have the synapses in between the neurons that implement the memory. And so you see that because neural networks are this huge this huge net of neurons entangled with synapses means that you have the memory that is in extremely close proximity to the computing. In fact, synapses give directly the memory to the neurons that they connect. And so memory is immediately here, and that's why you have a very, very low energy consumption in these networks. Yes?
Yeah, you have a super naive question, because how sure are we that this actually works? I'm not aware of this, so like for me, a neuron is just a link that we have in the brain, no? It's more a cable than something else. But for example, how sure are we that the synapse, the factor that gives memory, what the biologist can say to us?
Like, yes, I mean, yes, this is well known that memory is stored in synapses. So, I mean, now, you know, there are more and more techniques that neuroscientists can use to image the brain. And I mean, for example, they have been able to image the formation, the creation of the synapses, and see them with time and how they form, etc. And so, they can even make some experiments where, for example, they do experiments with animals, you know, and so the animals often have a bad experience from it, for example, mouse, and they can look at their brains before and after they learn, and they see the modification at the level of synapse and everything. So, yes, so. I would say that you can see neurons as cells that have indeed a long cable, and synapses are these elements inside that connect the cables of the neurons together, and that really hold long-term memory. Neurons also have a short-term memory. We'll see that later. Yes?
So how do you define the synapse memory? Is it really the weights as in a neural network, or is it more something that arises if you have an ensemble? Can you give
What is the definition?
If you have one neuron with a synapse?
Yes. So what you mean? I guess you mean that it's a bit strange because the synapse is an element of memory, and then you have the global memory that is distributed, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. It's like that. I cannot say much more. As we will see a bit later, in a neural network, this. Synapses are just seen as some modulation of the information, and what is important is to be able to memorize this weight. Yes. The brain is extremely complicated, so this is a completely simplified way of seeing things. Often, people in neural network in artificial intelligence are only interested in the cortex. Where you can see everything is a bit homogeneous and looking like some huge networks with layers of neurons and synapses. But of course, we know that there is memory in the cortex, but of course, we know that then information moves to other areas, like the hippocampus, where this is really stored. But today, in AI, this kind of things is not at all considered.
Sorry, but in that direction, so how do we have to understand memory then? It's just it's the path that basically information takes from one neuron to the other one? So, I mean, you have a bunch of them.
In a neural network, and I think, well, we will come back to that, but I will really try to think about, because we don't know how the brain is working exactly, right? So what we know for sure is that artificial neural network can do things interesting, and then I'm going to refer to that. And in that case, memory is just the weight. Yeah, the way the synapse is going to let the information flow. Okay. Okay, so what was I saying? Yes, so because of this organization of our computers, of our processors, we are going to run into some problems, because I was saying, you see, neural networks are like some huge fit function. You have all these weights, all these parameters. And the thing is that the larger this fit function, I mean, the more parameters, the better you fit anything, right? And so this is what happens. So people in computer science are trying to increase the number of parameters. This is what you see here, number of parameters, function of time. And you see here, these are typical state-of-the-art algorithms for image recognition. And this already consumes like hundreds of kilowatts to run. And this has about 100 million parameters. Okay, and people are trying, of course, to increase. And I discovered here that they even tried today to make some neural networks that have 10 to the 14 parameters. And so this is huge. And whereas you can still run those in the middle on GPUs, the ones that I put a red circle around, this is only going to work on supercomputers, is going to consume megawatts and be real slow and will not enable any real-time learning. And so what it means is that using our current chips, what we have today, for example, we will never be able to have a fully autonomous car, for example. It's not going to happen because we cannot, I mean, to have a fully autonomous car, I mean, so that is not linked by Wi-Fi or 5G to the server, you will need to have this number of parameters inside your car. And I mean, this is never going to be able to be in the back of your car, right? So, so we need to change something. And what is interesting, again, is to see that this number of parameters, 10 to the 14, 10 to the 15, is the number of synapses in the brain, okay? So our neural network here has about 10 to the 15 parameters. It has 100 billion of neurons, and it consumes less than a light bulb. So really, it really makes sense to try to get inspiration of the brain to build energy-efficient neuromorphic chips. And what it means is that it also makes sense to come back to this architecture, to try to make chips that have this physical layout, so to make physical neurons connected by physical synapses that are devices that enable memory really in between the neurons. Because in that way, you avoid this transfer between logic and computing that consumes so much energy and that is makes the devices so slow. And this should really enable real-time learning with very nice energy efficiency. Yes.
So if you have to, if you build this huge machine anyway, and okay, maybe it's inefficient, but do you think then it's already possible to simulate the actual working of a brain if it has the same number of neurons? Does that, do you think that means it can already perform as well?
If we were able to? No, I think not, because of course the problem is that we don't know exactly what are the functions of neurons and synapses in the brain, right? So what if we had, we could imitate some properties of neurons, we can imitate some properties of synapses, make huge networks, we can, but then if you don't have the algorithm also, it's not going to give anything interesting. So it's a bit what I'm going to try to say in that talk, is that we, at the same time as we develop this architecture, we need to think of the algorithm. And you see that you cannot really dissociate the algorithm from the structure, from the what the neuron and what the synapses do. And so that's why I believe it's so interesting to be in this field, because as a physicist or an experimentalist or a theorist, you need to think at the same time of the physics of the devices and the physics that will make this neural network compute. And this is what is really, really nice. Okay. Yeah, so I think, and so today, I mean, really people agree that we have to go in this direction. And so they agree to the point that even CMOS industries that tend to be rather conservative have started to develop a lot of chips trying to have this physical layout. And one of the most beautiful recent success and very well-known chip was developed by IBM. So this chip is called the True North chip. And they have completely redesigned, I mean, completely redefined the way they design CMOS. And they have made a chip that has this architecture here. So you see it's very modular. You see modules that are deeply connected. I mean, they are collected in parallel through these gray buses. And also in each of these clusters, you see that you have a green part, and it's the neuron part. And you have a purple part, and these are synapses, these are memories. And you see they have really put memory in as much as close as they could to processing. And thanks to this design, they have achieved a very, very highly efficient computing. So this chip power consumption is only 20 milliwatts per centimeter square. That should be compared to our processors that are typically 100 watts per centimeter square. So this is very, very impressive. And I think it proves the point that if you put memory close to processing, you can achieve a very low power consumption. However, this chip also somehow shows the limitations of CMOS today, because it's a rather big chip. It's like that, you know. It has 5 billion transistors, so it's almost as much as you have in the latest generation of processors. So it's a high-tech chip, very expensive. And still, first, it cannot perform incredible neuromorphic tasks. So what it can do is take video streams in which it identifies bicycles from cars, this kind of thing. But it's not very difficult. It's not state of the art, and it cannot do more. And also, it cannot learn. So the neural network is simulated on a big computer, on GPUs. And then the parameters are defined. And then they are injected in the memory blocks here. And then the chip can perform, right? And so this is basically more or less the state of the art of this kind of CMOS chip. So when a chip cannot learn but still can compute, it's called inference. It does the inference. Learning is a step where you train the network, and when it just performs its computation, it's called inference. And so how come that such a beautiful chip with so many transistors cannot do more? Well, I mean, again, it's because transistors are, of course, nanoscale devices, but they are just a switch. So if you want to imitate neurons, you need to put a lot of transistors together, tens of transistors. If you want to imitate synapses, you need to put hundreds of transistors together, and you need to add memory, because CMOS doesn't have a memory. And so SRAMs, so CMOS memory, is very expensive and takes a lot of area. And so in the end, what happens is that each neuron and each synapse is huge. So you see here you have this cluster that we saw for the True North chip. This is here you have the scale bar, so this is 100 microns. And here you have the memory part, and here you have the neuron. Okay, and so you see that in this chip that is fully digital, the memory part and the neuron part are typically 100 micrometers wide. And so it may seem not so large, I mean, but in fact, remember that today we mainly know how to do 2D architecture. We don't really know how to go to 3D. So if I take these numbers and I take the number of synapses in the brain, the number of neurons in the brain, and I try to put everybody on a chip with these lateral dimensions, that's equivalent to a circuit wafer of 300 meter diameter. Okay, so it's not enough. It's not good enough. And so this is an example of a digital chip. And here, other people are trying to do analog CMOS chips. And you see again that here this has 4 million neurons and 1 billion synapses. But this consists of many, many wafers that are connected through this huge red cable. You see, and it takes it's a huge supercomputer again. So this underlines why CMOS alone is not going to be enough for running the future generation of neural networks. And so, in fact, if we say, okay, our dream is the following. We want to make a very small chip like that, and we would like to run a state-of-the-art neural network. So it means that in this small chip, we need to be able to put 100 millions of neurons and even more synapses, okay? Then you do the calculation. I have 1 centimeter squared. how many, what is the minimal size, maximal size of each device? Well, you see that they should be, their maximum size should be 1 micrometer large, each synapse and each neuron. Okay? So what does it mean? It means that we need to do nanoneurons and we need to do nanosynapses. We need to develop novel devices that have interesting properties for neural function, for synaptic function at the nanoscale. Okay, so that's the first challenge. But you may say, okay, I can succeed. But then there is another challenge, is that you need to connect all these devices together. And they need to be very, very densely connected. So in neural networks today, typically there are 10 to 100 synapses per neuron. But intelligence in biology shows that the larger connectivity you have, the more intelligence it looks like the animals can have. And for example, we have, in average, 10,000 synapses per neuron. Okay? And so it's difficult to really see what does it mean. Okay? So I'm going to show you a small movie where German neuroscientists have taken slices of brains and they have reconstructed every axon, every cable of the neuron and every synapse, and you are going to see how it looks like. Now, this is what it means to have 10,000 wires per neuron. So you see the complexity, right? So it's 3D, it's totally entangled, and what is very important is that all these wires, they are entangled, but they connect very precisely through synapses, and they don't short-circuit, because otherwise it would be too easy. And also, you see that these holes where you have the camera, these are the blood vessels. And this is very important, because it shows that you need to find ways to bring energy, to give gain to this system, okay? So this is very challenging.
Where are the neurons?
Yeah, here I don't think we just see the cables. This is from a retina, and we only see the axons. I don't think I'm not sure we see the neurons here. Yeah. Okay. So, but this was just to give you a hint of the difficulty. But we are here for to try to reply and face this challenge. So so now this is the interactive part of the of the course. So I really count on you. So I mean, I'm not asking a complicated question, but it's just having seen that. So you see that we need this huge number of devices, that we need to connect them together. Given this video, what do you think that materials and physics and devices should, what are the, I mean, general features that they should have for neuromorphic computing? You have some, but I mean, really, I'm not talking about anything technical. I mean, just the common sense. If you say, okay, I want to do neuromorphic computing, what kind of architecture do you need? Do you have any idea? Sorry?
Non-binary?
Yeah, for example, I'm going to write here. Non-binary. Okay. Yeah.
Can it be long-range interaction because of huge connectivity?
Long-range interaction. Yeah. Should it be flat?
That means 3D.
Do we need big devices? Yeah, adaptive, or people in neuroscience, they like to say plastic. can be what?
It can be bigger. It doesn't have to be super small.
Yeah, it's true, because, for example, in the brain, neurons are not that small. They are like 100 micron wide, but they are, yeah, you're in 3D, yeah. So there is some compromise, yeah. Can you have only passive devices? So you need gain, I think. Yeah.
Non-linear?
Yes, non-linear. And so you need to. So when we say there are 10 to the sound, yes. So you have one neuron, and then you have it branches out, you know. So it's called the fan in, fan out. You need this huge fan in, fan out. Anything else? I don't know how to say in English. Okay, no shortcut. Insulator, no shortcut, okay. Okay, I see. Let's see what I wrote, I don't remember. Did we say everything? Yeah, low energy consumption, we said. Tunability, yeah, we need memory, of course, everywhere. Nanoscale, except if we can go to 3D. We didn't say endurance. You want, if the device breaks immediately, it's not going to work. The fan in, fan out, I said. Interconnectivity, we saw with the video. Some practical thing also is that probably, is depending on the algorithm, maybe we have a magic algorithm is going to learn all by itself, but most probably we need to read and write many parts. And so you need to be able to access these devices, even if it's this huge, crazy network. We need gain. We probably need these things to be active. They can be dynamical, reconfigurable. This is the plasticity. Multifunctional also, because if it's not necessary, but probably if we want to make this kind of devices, we need to make neurons and we need to make synapses, okay? But it's ideally, they need to be made with the same technology because it's difficult to have different technology put together. Well, we can. It started to happen. But if we could make both with the same technology, it would be great. So multifunctional, 3D. It would be nice if we could self-assemble this stuff, of course, because it's very complicated. And in practice, we should find ways to make this easily manufacturable. And in an ideal world, it would be very low cost. Okay. So this is what we want to do. But then I think we come to a question that was looming around, is that how can we imitate something that we don't understand yet, right? Because the brain, we don't know it. So today, there are two main trends. I'm going to try to describe these two trends. The first one is to say, okay, artificial intelligence is doing very impressive tasks. So let's try to map this algorithm on the chip. And the other possibility that I will describe later is to take inspiration from neuroscience to try to go further than that. But so mapping artificial intelligence to hardware. So what time is it? Okay. So as you know, there's been recently very, very impressive progress in artificial intelligence in these algorithms. So now they can do better than humans at some tasks. Like, for example, they can all the checkerboard games, they can do better than humans. They can beat the world champions at poker, at Go. They are better than human, better than inattentive human at image recognition. And they are now extremely impressive at image generation. So these are fake people, right? They don't exist. Yeah, this is the power of NVIDIA. Yes, yes. So very soon, well, already now, you cannot trust videos anymore. I mean, it's over. Okay, so
are there not
special neural networks to recognize which people are real and which are generated?
No, they are trying to. But still, I mean, before, imagine you some fake video spread. Nobody would listen to your neural network that, that certifies if it's true or not. So, yeah. So I would like to give you, I don't know if you know how they work, I would like to try to give you some general idea. So these neural networks, so they are called deep networks, meaning that they have many layers of neurons, and they have this kind of structure where the information is moving in that direction. And what they do is that they reduce dimensionality. So for example, they take an image, so that's millions of pixels, and they have in the end to recognize a person or the color of the hair or something. So it really reduces to a million dimension to only a few questions in the end. Is it a human or is it a dog or whatever? So you have only a few classes, so you reduce the dimension. And so what these deep neural networks do, the function of this depth is to little by little extract the important features. And so here, this is what is illustrated. So the first layers are going to learn to recognize the basic, the different orientations that you can find in an image. So the contours. Then the next layers are going to be more abstract, so they are going to recognize some features in faces, if they are shown faces, so they can recognize the nose, the eye, the ear. And then the next layers are going to be even more general, so they are going to be responsive to the face, to the concept of face. And then you have the output. So the depth allows little by little to extract abstract concepts. Okay? So it's not an explanation here, it's just, what's happened.
We always saw those kind of graph, and they are really linear, so you have different kind of layer of neuron, and they are connected by synapses. It is for computational limitation, or because there's no leak gain to make more connection, I mean, for the first to the tree, or back and forth, and things like this?
You mean, for example, why it goes that way, and not like that? Why is there no recurrence?
No recurrence, no loop, and
yes.
Like that one neuron can be connected to like everywhere else.
Okay, so why not? First, there are some networks that have some recurrence, but recurrence complexify learning and the learning rule, and so people use it only when it's necessary. And so for recognizing images, typically you don't need recurrence, because what recurrence brings is some memory, in fact, some kind of memory of past input, some memory of the internal dynamics of the networks. And to recognize an image, you don't really need a memory. But for example, when you want to do speech recognition, to recognize a sentence, you need to remember the words before. The network has to still have this information inside, and then you need recurrence, and then there are some loops. But until recently, they were not very performant, but now some algorithms that are called long short-term memories that have some recurrence are the ones used for speech recognition. But they are much more difficult to train, yeah. Yes, so in general, yes, you decrease the dimension as you go that way. What here is not shown, is not really apparent, is that these are the algorithms that are used for image recognition. They are called convolutional neural networks. And so, in fact, you have many different outputs. So you have, it's like all these little pictures that you see correspond to many different outputs of the neural network here. So it's a kind of tensor, it's not a matrix. So. But all this, you can find easily on the internet. It's just, okay. And so I'm just going to try to give you the general concept of how it works. And then when if you are interested, there are many courses on deep networks that you can follow. It's not very complicated. And so how does it work? Well, as we say, it reduces the dimension. So you want to go from the image, millions of pixels where you have pixels, cats, dogs, and you need to recognize if it's a cat or a dog. And so if you go from millions here to just one neuron that says this one should output one if it's a cat, and another neuron here should output one if it's a dog. So how does it work? Well, you see, what you want is that each time you have a cat, you kind of route the information to this neuron here. You want to create some kind of chain reaction in your neural network that will always trigger some kind of avalanche chain reaction that will go to this neuron when it's a cat. And you want that when you have a dog, it's going to take another pass, and it's going to do this domino-like chain reaction and go to this other neuron. And so how can you achieve that? Well, the first thing that you need is that you need some nonlinearity. And this is what neurons do. They are nonlinear, and this allows to guide the information through this network, because if it was proportional, if the output was proportional to the input, you could not have this focused information like that. So neurons are nonlinear like that. They can let the information pass or saturate it, cut it. And in addition, well, this is achieved by choosing very precisely the synapses, these synaptic weights. So the synapses, as we said, they let the information go through or not. So there are weights that are between plus one and minus one, typically. And so the input of a neuron is the sum, the weighted sum of the outputs of the previous neurons. This sum here. And then you go through this function that is a nonlinear activation function of the neuron. Okay? And it is this choosing these weights that will also spread the information in the network and allow to converge it here and here. And so what happens is that at the beginning, a neural network is not working because the weights are typically random, chosen completely randomly. And so you need to train them, so you need to adjust the synapses. And so how can this be done? Well, what you do is that you use supervised learning. So you need to train the network, so you need to know the error that it does in order to train it. So what you need, if you want to recognize cats and dogs, is you need to have millions of examples of images where you have cats and dogs and they are labeled. Cat, dog, okay? Because like that, you put the image of a cat, you look at what the neural network outputs, and if it's right, the error, you compare the result to the label, and you know if it's right and wrong, and you can compute the error. And then when you know the error, you can use this very important learning rule that is at the heart of all the success of neural networks recently, that is called backpropagation of errors. So what you do is that you take your cat here, image, you put it, and you compute, you see the weighted sum at the first layer, then you take the nonlinearity, so weighted sum, nonlinearity, weighted sum, nonlinearity, you get to the output. Here, you see the result of the computation. You look at the label of your image, you compare, you have your error, and once you have your error, what you want to do is to correct each, to change each weight a little bit so that it contributes precisely to decrease the overall error. And so what you do for that is that you perform gradient descent. You would like each weight to, this is the error, you see, to correct for the error, to correct for its contribution to the error. And backpropagation is just a very simple way if you can, if this nonlinearity of the neuron can be derived. Okay, you can take the output and by backpropagating the error using the chain rule of derivation, it's very easy to calculate what should be the modification of each synapse. Okay, it's just a chain derivation starting from here. And so thanks to this backpropagation of error, you can really modify each weight, little by little, and thanks to this, you can achieve very high precision learning. But this is, as you see, completely, it's called supervised learning, because you need to have all these bank of images where you know the result, and then you need not only to have this, but then to know the result, then you need to have some kind of teacher that is going to change each weight independently. Okay.
So this backward propagation, that's not unique, I guess, in the sense that there's not the... So you, for example, you get an error, you have a cat instead of where it was a dog. But then if you start changing the weights back, you can do that in multiple ways, I guess, to get the...
So I think that in this forward networks, I'm not sure that there are multiple ways to do it, because the chain rule is going to give you exactly how you should change each weight. But then, of course, you have many parameters to adjust. Backpropagation is very precise, but you don't know what this alpha should be to perform well. You don't know what the architecture should be. So these are called hyperparameters, how many neurons per layer, how many synapses per neuron. This has to be found, and it's try and error. So this is called tuning the hyperparameters. So often, a neural network can be said to learn very, very efficiently, but this is once you have found the architecture. This is often the most difficult step. Okay, so this is the algorithm, and this is what works the best today. And so if you want to map AI system to algorithm to devices to physical systems, it means, yes, as we said, we want to do nano devices. Okay, nanosynapses, nanoneurons. And these neurons, they have to be, like in hardware, to be able to implement a nonlinear function at minima. And the synapses, they need to implement the weights. So implement the weights means that they should modulate the information that goes through these neural networks. Also, it's not only that they should do that, but they should not only modulate the information, but keep a memory of this weight, so remember this weight. And ideally, it's even better if they could do this weighted sum, because you not only have to do the weight, but you need to do the weighted sum. And this in CMOS is very costly and requires a huge circuit. Okay? What are the solutions today? Do you have any question before I move on to the next part? Yes?
Yeah, so are the weights the majority of the parameters that the neural networks have?
Yes. So you have weights. What I did not say is that you always have a bias also. That is a special weight, and its input is 1, because it helps to choose where you are with respect to the nonlinearity. Apart from these weights, the other parameters are called hyperparameters, and they are the architecture, they are the learning rule, everything. Okay, so how can we do that in hardware? Well, the most studied way to do it today are with memory systems. So the rationale here is, we are good at doing a CMOS system. There are electronics, so let's have the information be the charge, the electrical current. We have many more synapses than neurons in the system, so what is important is to shrink the synapse before everything. So we want nanosynapses, so we are going to devices, nanodevices as synapses, and we are going to do the neurons in CMOS, because there are less neurons than there are synapses, so it doesn't matter if they are a little bigger. And so we are going to have the neurons in CMOS here, and we are going to try to stack the synapses on top. So what are memory stores? So memory stores is a short umbrella term for memory resistor. And so they are just nano resistors. And why are they valve for the information? It's because when the information is electrical current and you want to modulate an electrical current, when you put a conductance, a resistance, it's going to modulate the electrical current. But it's good, but they need to be analog and tunable. So typically, a memory store will have this kind of behavior. So you have the resistance as a function of the voltage, and you see that you can go from a low resistance state to high resistance state, and that you can tune it depending on the way you modulate the voltage. And what is important is once you turn off the voltage, the resistance stays where it was, because like that, it memorizes the weight. So this is the principle of memory stores. And so again, what is important is that they should be analog, tunable, and have this memory, and be small, of course. And in fact, there are many, many ways to achieve that. And so there are many systems that are studied today, and there are two main competitors, I would say. The most famous ones are redox memory stores and phase change memory stores. So do you know the principles of these memory stores? Okay, so for the redox memory stores, the idea is simple. You take two metallic electrodes, and in between, you put about 300 or a few hundred nanometers of insulating material. Okay, and so this is insulating, right? So when you want to push a current through it, the resistance is infinite. And then you apply a voltage and you ramp it up. And so you increase the electrical field. And at some point, you have some kind of dielectric breakdown. And so then it really depends on the materials at that point, whether your electrodes are active or not, if the matrix is passive or is doing something, this insulator. But in the end, what is going to happen is you are going to have some atoms that migrate through the insulator, some metallic atoms. And you are going to create a filament, some kind of metallic bridge between your two electrodes due to the electric field. And if you are smart and you are able to control by putting some compliance or something the creation of this filament, at the tip here, you can have only a few atoms. So this filament can be super thin. And so once it's created, of course, you have a shortcut. So the resistance is super low. And you are down. And so it would not be interested if it would be stuck here. But then what happens is that because you have this very, very thin filament, when you apply then an opposite voltage, you can retract the filament. And again, a voltage in the opposite direction, you can create again. You see, you can move the filament that can bridge or not the two electrodes. And because if you move it a little bit here, you can have tunneling of electrons here. You can, in fact, explore all this range of resistance. This is how many memory stores work today, redox memory stores. Another type of memory store are phase change memory stores. So they are made typically of chalcogenide materials, which are used in a compact disc. And so these materials can have transitions between a crystalline to an amorphous state. And of course, as you imagine, so when you inject electrons through these two types of arrangements, atomic arrangements, they don't see the same electrical path. And so this and this have very different resistances. And what happens is that you can have mixed phases of amorphous and crystalline. So in that way, you can also explore different states between the on and off states. Okay. So this is how the main memory stores work, right? But there are many, many other possibilities. And so, but what is interesting, so memory stores, you see, and because, yeah, and they can be made very small because this can be small, or this can be scaled down to 10 nanometers, typically, in diameter. And it can have very high ratio of difference of resistance between the on and off states, up to several hundreds or thousands or more. So this is nice. And but here, in fact, so you see, we have the valve for the information. So it's great, it's a synapse, but it can do even better, in fact. Because you see, memory stores are going to be synapses between neurons. And we said these neurons, they are going to be made in CMOS. And what they are going to do is they are going to deliver voltages to these synapses. Okay? And so here we have the neurons. And they are, if we connect them like that by memory stores that have these different conductances, and each neuron delivers a voltage UI, well, you see that if I connect these neurons with these memory stores in that way, the current that flows here by the laws of electricity is the weighted sum of the input voltages by the conductance of the memory store. So memory stores, by their physics, by the laws of electricity, do the weighted sum that is at the heart of neural networks. And so what is really nice is that you can imagine to build huge networks like that that are called crossbar arrays of these memory stores. What you see here are the electrodes that connect the memory store. At each cross point here, you have a memory store. And here, these crossbars can connect neurons that are attached to the electrodes here to neurons that are attached here. Because you see, if you have many voltages, all these voltages applied here, the current that goes out is a weighted sum of the input voltages of the pre-neurons and can go to the next neuron directly, in fact. So it's a very nice way to densely connect many, many neurons together. And so the thing is that if you want to build dense networks, you just want to use these memory stores. You don't want to put any active devices below, like transistors or diodes, because it would make the things larger. But so if you don't put any active element below, you can make them dense, but it's going to be purely resistive. And so if it's too big, this network, the current path will be spreading out, and then it's going to be difficult to control. So typically, you can imagine to make hundreds by hundreds of memory stores arrays. So this would already be a nice connectivity. But if we want to go to 10,000 synapses per neuron, it means that you need to find ways to stack these things on top of each other. And so this is what has been proposed in this paper, where you see that the idea here is that you have the neurons here that deliver the voltage are in the CMOS below. And then you stack many layers of memory stores on top. And then you try through to have some vias that are going to connect these things with the different layers. And to do that, you need to be smart also on the way you make your matrices so that you can have space for the vias to come up. Okay? So this is not existing yet, in fact. But theoretically, you could reach 10,000 synapses per neuron. So it's an interesting path to explore. And what people today are doing in labs is that they are making this, studying these devices, these networks. And there are people also that are developing chips, integrating CMOS and memory stores at the same time. But we are not yet at the stage where we can stack them in high dimension.
What's the bottleneck with the stacking? What makes it so hard?
Well, I mean, these are novel devices. So it's already very difficult to, I mean, there are not yet chips that co-integrate CMOS with this, I mean, neuromorphic chips. And then when you want to make several layers, you need to insulate them, and then you need to to avoid crosstalk. You need to bring the energy at the different levels. That's the difficulty. It's a technical challenge, but it's not impossible. Okay, and so this would be very nice because if we succeed to do that, then memory stores really open a path to energy efficient learning. So there is this work by IBM. I'm going to show a little bit more of their work. But they have made some experiments and some simulation, and they have estimated that with such a network, where you have CMOS neurons and arrays of memory stores together, you can expect to be able to accelerate neural network by a factor of 100 compared to GPUs, while consuming 100 less energy or power. Okay, so this would be a huge gain, and it will enable to have chips that can learn in real time, which doesn't exist today. But this is for the future, because for now, this is just a beginning field. And so where are we now? So a few years ago, there have been the very first results of neuromorphic computing with memory stores. So people have built these arrays in their labs. And they have started to test to try to do backpropagation. So they had the memory stores and they emulated the neurons with lab equipment, basically. And they have shown, for example, in this paper by IBM, they have shown that they can do handwritten digit recognition. So it's a database that is called MNIST, and it's really a standard for checking your neural network. Okay. And so they had about 2,000 synapses. that were phase change synapses with an active element below each synapse. And they have achieved a classification rate of about 82% on this database, MNIST. And so this was impressive because it was the first time there could be some backprop on this. It's not so easy to do it. Yes?
Do you know how long does it take to get the results?
Yeah, it's long in that case because in this case, experimentally, because the learning, there is not a dedicated CMOS circuit for learning. So you have your crossbar, then you have your nanovoltmeter, your pulse generator, and in between you have a computer, right? And so everything goes through the computer. There is a kind of loop, and it takes like very, very long. But this could be completely accelerated if you had the dedicated hardware, and this CMOS with the memory stores, and this is why you could expect to be 100 times faster than GPUs and gain this if you put the two together. But in this demonstration, it was not yet done. You had just the memory stores. Okay, and so is it good, this result? Well, first, yes, it's good, but it's not extremely good because on MNIST, typical neural networks of this size, they can achieve like 86%, 96%, sorry. Okay, and so this is strongly reduced compared to ideal neural networks. And why is it? Well, this is because when you do backprop, I told you, you need to really very precisely adjust each synaptic weight. But you know, devices, they are nano devices. I don't know if you have doing that in your lab, but they are very imprecise, they tend to drift, they are not completely analog. And they are noisy, and also it's a big problem for backpropagation. They are non-linear, so when you apply a voltage and you expect them to change this much, well, it's going to vary where you are, depending where you are on the curve. And so this completely modifies the way they converge. And so this is a big challenge for neuromorphic computing, is that you need to find ways to fix this, to improve the results. And so how can you do it? Okay, sorry, I have before I say how can you do it, I would like to, what time is it? Yes. To say that this is a neural network with memory stores, but there are the same efforts to try to do this in optics. So there are examples of deep learning in optics where people are implementing, so this time the information that propagates is light, and neurons modulate light, and synapses are based on different ways to modulate the light. So here they use phase shifters, here they use diffraction. And just rapidly, you can have a look at these publications. So they do deep networks, so kind of similar STOI implementation, but also in all the cases, there are problems of that the success rate is rather low. And in all these cases, is due to the fact that there are imperfection of devices, okay? And so what can we do for that? How can we improve things? Well, there are two solutions. First, you can work on your nano devices. So today there are huge efforts in trying to optimize devices to make memory stores highly analog. Suddenly I feel like I should say something intelligent. Analog, very analog, very linear. So you see there is this effort to get to super nice memory stores. Another proposal is to say, okay, the memory stores have advantages. They have this memory. They have this long-term memory, but at the same time, they are imprecise. So maybe we should complement them with other devices that don't have much memory, but are very precise. And so the same team by IBM has implemented hybrid synapses where they complement a memory store with a capacitor. Capacitors are volatile, but they are extremely precise. And so they do the computation with the capacitor, and then they store the result on the memory store, basically. And they do this transfer all the time. And in that way, they have obtained 98% classification rate on the same database. So now they are at the state of the art. Okay. So maybe this is a possibility. And in parallel to this effort on devices, there are a lot of work on algorithm, from people from AI, because they would like to run their computers faster. So to try to find algorithms that are less demanding on hardware, that do not require, for example, to have ultra-precise weights, because now in computers, synaptic weights are coded on 32 floating bits, floating point digits. And of course, if you were able to reduce this precision, you would have more memory or less memory requirements, so you could be faster. And so it has been shown that, in fact, for inference, not for learning, but for inference, you need only binary weights, in fact. You don't need the full analog path. And that for training neural networks, you need to have some analog precision, but only 8 bits are enough. Okay, and this is reducing and reducing and reducing. So there is this double convergence that I hope will allow to solve and allow to implement backprop in hardware. Okay, so this is the challenges of doing AI in hardware, in fact, which are implementing backprop in hardware, is that you need very high precision devices. You don't want devices to be nonlinear. You need to tune each device according to the gradient that was learned at each step. And you need to store these gradients. And all this should be solved. And okay, so these are the challenges of backprop in hardware. And so, yeah.
So you mentioned the supervised learning, but I don't see how you are. This is still supervised learning.
This is still supervised. Yeah. Today, all the methods that are super efficient are mainly supervised learning. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And there is no route to unsupervised learning.
I will discuss it a little bit after the break. yes, but we can take questions. Yeah.
What is the score of humans on this handwriting test?
I don't know. Probably, the same, I guess. I never tried. I don't know. What do you say?
It's around 95%.
Yeah, it's the same, it's the same than neural networks, yeah.
In an experiment, you showed about 83%. What was the connectivity of neurons in that?
In which experiment?
When you showed up 83%.
83%?
Okay, generally, 82%, yeah.
This one? What was the connectivity? I'm not sure. In total, there are 200,000 synapses, and you can check in the paper, I think it's a fully connected network. So all the neurons are connected to all the neurons before, you see? So there are 500 by 200 or something at each layer. Yeah, it's very densely connected, yeah. It's not a convolutional neural network. Do you have more questions before we take a small break? Yeah.
Yeah, can you share with what you said at the beginning about real autonomous car? So I was a bit confused because you said we need way more confidence in power, but I don't know what is your definition of real autonomous car, because as far as I know, we have cars that are running on road right now, and they are autonomous, and they are better than human to drive. Same thing with planes and almost everything. So what do you mean with that?
I mean, when I say fully autonomous, I mean that do not need to be linked to the server, to the data center. And now we don't have cars. They are learning. Everything is done on the data center. It's not done in your car.
Okay, they train them, and after that they take the other and put them in the car.
Yeah. Okay. Or when it learns, it's the data center that learns. It's not
the
learning.
The network is fixed when it's in the car.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it can do inference, and it can only do basic image recognition. I mean, it's not like taking interesting decision or thinking. So I mean, okay, if we wanted a really smart car, we cannot use what we have now. Okay, time for a break then. So we start again at 9, no? Okay. Okay, all right. So second part of this talk. So in the first part, we try to see how we could do artificial intelligence. But of course, it would be very exciting to go further and take more inspiration of the brain. Because as we know, the brain is much more complicated than these very abstract formal neural networks. So there are many more features. You've seen these neural networks typically. Neurons are static, they are just a nonlinear function. In the brain, neurons emit spikes. They are active, they are dynamical, they are stochastic. They have memory. Synapses have this long-term memory that could be assimilated to the weight, but they have more dynamics than that. They also have a short-term memory, they can forget. In addition, there are more devices than neurons and synapses. There are many more cells. There are, in particular, cells that are called astrocytes that people were thinking. You don't have a very good place. So these astrocytes, people thought they were useless, but it seems that in fact they are very important for many things, and they seem to mediate some communication between neurons. And there is not only electricity, there are hormones that provide some kind of global signal to all these things. So it's very, very, very complex. But then the difficulty, if you want to imitate the brain with your nano device or your hardware, is where do you start? What is it? What is useful to implement in all these things? And then I don't have a good answer. The only answer is to use your intuition and read neuroscience papers and then try to find something interesting. So I'm going to try to show you some examples of what people have done. It's going to be a bit kind of a catalog, so I hope it's not going to be boring because there are many, many efforts in many directions. So I'm trying to show what has been done and I hope it's not going to be too repetitive. Of course, the first to do that were people using CMOS. I mean, it dates from a long time ago, and I need to cite this because it's very important work. It was pioneered by Carver Mead in the 80s, and he realized that in biology, very often you have some kind of exponential behavior of a system. So, for example, in the brain, you have all these ions that are at thermal equilibrium, okay? And so they have this Boltzmann energy distribution, and they also experience some energy barriers. And so when you modulate the barrier with the voltage, you are going to also change this Boltzmann distribution. And so very often, you have current as a function of voltage curves that have this exponential behavior. So, for example, here in his paper, he shows that the currents through neuron membrane as a function of a nerve membrane as a function of voltage. So, this is a log scale and this is voltage. Also, the current out of a synapse as a function of the voltage on the synapse membrane evolves exponentially. And so you find this behavior very often in biology because this is useful to provide gain. And it's also useful in semiconductor physics to provide gain. And so the idea of Carver made was to use CMOS to do that because a transistor, when it's a subthreshold, also has this exponential behavior. And so he thought that using CMOS in this region was interesting because of the link with biology and also because you can save energy because you work below the threshold. And so this gave rise to a lot of work and beautiful realization. And so I'm not going to cover this in detail. You can have a look if you want. So there are many people who develop CMOS chips that are really, really linked with neuroscience. And what they try to do is to take some models from neuroscience and design them in CMOS and try to learn something from this design. They think that if you try to make a brain in hardware, you will find some difficulties, and these difficulties will help you to understand how the brain is working because the brain is a hardware system. Okay, and so here you have some example of chips that have been done. So this is from the Human Brain Project in Heidelberg. So this is an accelerated chips working with analog technologies. Well, you have a very famous work in Stanford and at the ETH Zurich also. And so I'm going to try to list different technologies and try to put their advantage. I tried to list some advantages and disadvantages. It's not always easy, but for CMOS, we have already seen a little bit what are the advantages and the disadvantages. CMOS is the basis today for current electronics, so it's commercial. You have design rules, so you can make big systems. Disadvantages, we have seen that memory is costly in CMOS. We have problems of connectivity, and this is the end of Moore's law, so miniaturization is going to stop, so we need to complement CMOS. But so what kind of materials can we use for that? So there are many possibilities, so this is where I hope it's not going to be too much of a catalog, but among the most interesting, maybe to start with, the most interesting materials are multifunctional oxides. Multifunctional oxides are a huge family, so it's difficult to describe them. It can go from very simple insulators to materials that have a strongly correlated physics. What is interesting is that this family of material can be tuned, their properties can be tuned in the bulk, and in addition, by putting them in thin layers together at the interface, we can put two different functional materials and obtain a new functionality at the interface. And so you can do a lot with these oxides, and this is interesting for neuromorphic computing. So let me try to give you some examples. So one of the first work in this area was a group of Aono in Japan. So they said, OK, let's take a memory store. OK, people use it as a synapse, right? But maybe we can give it a little bit more neuroscience-like functionality. When you make this metallic bridge, you know, when it is strong, you have non-volatile memory. So you have a long-term memory. But in fact, synapses not only have long-term memory, they only remember something well when they have a strong solicitation, you know, strong input. If they have only small input, they will remember for a while, but then they will forget. It's only when they are repeatedly, they receive the input repeatedly and strongly that they are going to memorize. And so the idea was the following, was to say, in fact, instead of writing it with a huge voltage pulse that creates this strong bridge, let's send a smaller voltage pulse so that it just creates a little bridge, you know, just really a few atoms here. And then, so if it only receives this small amount of voltage pulse, only a small bridge will be created. So if I stop, the bridge will by itself detach. Okay, so you forget. But then if I put more or stronger pulses, you're going to create a small bridge that is not going to stochastically detach. And so you will remember for a long term. So this kind of physics allows to implement short and long-term memory in synapses, for example. Another thing that is very interesting with oxides is to use temperature-driven phase transitions. So in the memory stores that we have seen, they are what we call bipolar. You put a positive voltage, you go to high resistance states, and it stays there. You put a negative voltage, it drops. Okay. There are some memory stores that are going to change their resistance because they undergo a phase transition that is triggered by temperature. Like, for example, in the VO2 or niobium oxide, these materials undergo a resistance to a conductor to insulating change that is induced by temperature. So what happens is that when you increase the voltage, the temperature increases and you transit and you transition. But then when you come back, because it's due temperature, it cools down. So it's unipolar and it comes back. Okay. And so this has no memory, but this has a negative differential resistance. And so you can use it, this peculiar behavior, to induce auto-oscillations. So if you use this kind of unipolar memory store, and you bias it here, and you add here a resistor and a capacitor in parallel to the memory stores. When you apply a voltage and you do it, well, you tune your circuit so that when the capacitor charges and discharges, you are on this line here. You see that you are going to go from high resistance to high resistance, low resistance as the capacitor charge and discharge, charge and discharge. And in that way, when you measure the voltage, the resistance is going to have this kind of dynamics. Okay, the capacitor charge, the memory store change resistance. Capacitor discharge, okay, that's why there is some kind of balance between the two, and that's why it keeps oscillating. And so in that way, you see that you can create some kind of neuron. And so it's very nice, and it has been done experimentally in a number of systems. And there is this recent paper where they use memory cells that are made with this material, VO2. And you see there are unipolar switching here. And what is really nice is that they show experimentally that depending on the circuit and the bias conditions, they can obtain all this kind of spiking behavior. And that really looks like biology. Yeah?
About the device you were talking about, the temperature-driven one, how sensitive is it to the environment? So do you have to put it in a specific temperature condition for the sensitive?
So I'm not an expert. It works at room temperature, but for VO2 and...
And for example,
Probably. So the whole idea is to really be very careful where you bias it, so that it really, you know, hits and cools, and it finds some kind of stable behavior. That's key. Of course, if you use a material that is going to have a phase transition at another temperature, low temperature, it will be low temperature. It depends on the... on the temperature of the phase transition. Yes. And so depending on the circuit and depending on the bias point, you can really achieve all this kind of spiking behavior that are extremely similar to what neurons can display in the brain. So because they can show regular spiking, they can show oscillations, they can show bursts, there are many kind of behavior. So this is very beautiful. Another thing that you can do with oxides is try to build memory stores that are based on other functionalities. So one of the things that we have seen is that these filamentary memory stores are really based on atomic motion. Okay, so you move atoms due to the voltage. And so at some point, this can induce a lot of variability. And this can induce also at some point that the device doesn't work anymore because it completely breaks. So you can try to imagine other types of memory stores. And we, in my lab, we try to imagine a memory store that would work not due to atomic motion, but due to electronic changes. So the idea is, how can we induce large resistance variation just due to electronic band structure variations? And what we had, the idea was to use a tunnel junction. So you have two metallic electrodes in blue and red. Two metals. In the middle, you have a tunnel barrier, very thin barrier. This barrier here is functional. It's a ferroelectric oxide, very thin. And so this ferroelectric oxide can have a polarization that points up or down. Okay? And the polarization, you can imagine, is going to change the potential in the device. And in particular, if it ups or down, is really going to change the way charges are distributed at the interface. Especially since we use two metals that have very different conductivities, so the screening of charges is going to be very different depending on if the polarization points up or down. And so what happens is that if it points up or down, the tunnel barrier that is seen by electrons is completely different. And so the way they are going to go through changes completely, and it modifies the resistance strongly. It can go from 10 to the 5 ohms to 10 to the 8 ohms. And what is nice also is that in a ferroelectric material, polarization is not going to switch just in one shot. In order to reverse, you are going first to nucleate domains of opposite polarization, and then you are going to apply more and more voltage pulses, and this is going to grow to nucleate and grow. And we have shown that in that way, we could create multiple resistance states because of these mixed phases, and that the resistance was really correlated with the ferroelectric domain behavior that we could image. And yes, so these are devices that we are studying in my lab. Other very interesting devices in this spirit, trying to get purely electronic memory stores, is to use MOT metal insulators materials. So these materials should be, let me remember, these materials should be, I don't want to say something wrong, I think they should be insulators, no, they should be conductors according to normal band theory, okay? But in fact, there are very, very strong electron-electron interactions. And due to that, they are insulators. But the band gap is very small between conductive and insulating. And so when you apply a voltage, you're really going to change their behavior, and you can induce a phase transition between the insulating and the conductive states. And this team here have shown that using these MOT insulators, you can create memory stores where you have these two metallic electrodes. You have the MOT insulator in between. And when you apply voltage patches, you are going to create a filament also. But it's not an atomic filament. It's a filament of charges. And if you apply a large voltage pulses, you are going to create a strong filament, so you can really have a memory. But if you apply smaller pulses, the filament can create and retract. And in that case, it gives some spiking behavior. So with this kind of system, you can imagine to do the synapse and the neuron with the same material. And this is what they are trying to develop now. Okay, so how do you want to? So now I'm going to try to give advantage and disadvantages of oxide materials. Do you want to help me first, or do you want me to show directly what I thought? You have some guesses. Do you want to communicate your guesses on the? on the no? Okay. Then I mean, these are my conclusions, and you don't have to agree. But I thought that the advantages of oxide. So first, oxide, it's a huge family. It's very difficult to conclude something general about oxides because they are all very different. But what is sure is that they are very interesting because they are multifunctional. So that's nice for neuromorphic computing. You can really have a very wide variety of physical phenomena that you can use for computing. And you can have very large effects. This on-off ratio can be huge, so it's nice for measurements. Disadvantages that I saw is that when you have these filaments and they are made of atoms, you can have some variability and some robustness issues, you see, because you move atoms repeatedly. Some of the beautiful materials that I showed, like MOT insulators, often they are exotic materials grown on exotic substrates, and so they are complex. And they are not always compatible with silicon. They can be, but it's an effort, so they have to be, you need to find ways to grow them on silicon. And also, because they are complex, they are not always models that describe very well their behavior, and this is a problem when you want to make a computing system. You need to be able to model your devices. Okay. Do you have some question on oxides? Yes.
When you were showing the device, you said that you can actually tune through different aesthesis curves of this device because you can scan over the domains.
This one, for example?
Yeah, exactly. And is it actually reversible, this thing? So, for example, can you start from the higher one and then go in the intermediate one?
Yes. Yes. So, for example, the way we proceed in that case, what we do is that we start in a given state, and then here, in this curve, we applied pulses, 20 nanosecond pulses, with a given amplitude, and we change the amplitude. For example, we have 1 volt, we go there, 1.5, etc. And then if we go there, we can start to apply negative voltage pulses, and we can, in that way, go where we want, more or less. Well, full control, we don't.
Yeah.
Let's not exaggerate. But we have some control on the behavior. Yes.
So, but for this one, you need to change the amplitude. You cannot give like 2 or 10.
So actually, there are some cumulative effects. Yes. Here it's not shown, but we keep applying the same pulse, it's going to increase and then saturate like that. And then you can, yeah. So. Often memory stores have these behaviors that they are cumulative. Okay, so phase change materials, these chalcogenides that have this amorphous to crystal phase transition, are also very interesting for neuromorphic, for more neuroscience-like computing. So they have been used for memory stores, but you can also use their stochastic switching for computing. And so they have done this in this paper. I'm not going to go through it in detail, but the advantages of this kind of materials, they are mature. I mean, they are developed today for memories. So that's why many results on neuromorphic computing are obtained with these materials. They have a high endurance. I think they are well understood and modeled. And there are a few disadvantages that these materials have some physics that, by the law of their physics, they are drifting. The voltage of the switch, the threshold is drifting. And also, the transition tends to be analog in one direction, but very sharp in the other one. So you need to reset your device to be analog again and reset if you want to. So it makes things a bit more complicated. Okay. Do you know what is spintronics? So spintronic materials are based on ferromagnetic materials, magnets that are piled. The basic structure is a magnetic tunnel junction here. So for example, you have two magnets separated by a thin insulator. And what is nice is that when you send current through these devices, you can control the magnetization. And so you can go from a parallel orientation of magnetization to anti-parallel. So these can be used to code zeros and ones. But you can do much more than that with spintronics. And in fact, you can, when you send a DC current, you can induce magnetization, sustained magnetization precession. So you can do many things also with spintronics, like oscillations, stochastic switching, memory stores. I'm not going to say much because tomorrow morning I'm going to talk about that. But it's interesting to exploit this magnetization dynamics for computing. And we are working on that on my lab. So in this case, this kind of technology is interesting for neuromorphic computing because it's very multifunctional. You can do many, many things with the same materials. It's well controlled and modeled. It has very high endurance because it's purely electronic effect. You don't need to switch to atomic motion. It's also developed in industry for memory, and it can potentially be stacked in 3D. But the big disadvantage is the resistance variations that are linked with magnetization switching are small. Just a factor 2 is not a factor 1,000, 2 or 3. And it's a bit difficult to achieve some gain in these structures, but people are trying. Okay, what time is it? Yeah, I'm going to go fast. Optics, many people are studying optics and photonics for neuromorphic computing. There's been a demonstration of neuromorphic task using the nonlinear dynamics of optical oscillators in some kind of looped system where you have a kind of recurrent neural network. They have demonstrated that they could classify spoken words with extremely rapidly, millions of words per second. And well, if you are interested, you can have more look into this work. And the advantages of optics for computing, I think, clearly are the speed, because optics is super fast. It's intrinsically parallel. The passive devices have no energy consumption. It can clearly go to 3D, so it can be used to connect many layers of neurons. The disadvantage is that there are many efforts to do in order to miniaturize these devices. They are not nanoscale. And if you use too many lasers, the energy consumption is going to explode. So it's important to try to minimize the energy consumption of the lasers. Okay, I think I'm not going to show everything, but superconductivity is very interesting for neuromorphic computing because Josephson junctions are dynamical objects that, due to their the phase dynamics of these junctions, they can spike like neurons. So each time you have a flux that goes through, you have a spike. People have recently found ways to give memory to Josephson junction by inserting magnetic clusters in the insulating barrier. And so this potentially allows to have neurons and synapses with the same technology. We all know the advantages and disadvantages of superconductivity. I think it's clear. And then there is a flurry of possibilities. So there are beautiful results recently with nano-mechanical, electromechanical oscillators with NEMS. What is nice with NEMS is that the frequency is compatible with, they are mechanical, so their frequency is compatible with biology. So they have shown that they could classify words pronounced directly because they react to the same frequencies as your voice. 2D materials are interesting to make memory stores. And of course, there is a lot of work on organic materials. which are very interesting because they could be compatible with biology. And also, they not only that, but I mean, they can be they have a low voltage switch. They can operate with voltages that are close to biology, so they can be very energy efficient. Okay. So that was a brief overview of many, many possibilities. So you see that here, only the imagination is your limit. But then, so if you are a hardcore material physicist, that might be enough for you. And it's very interesting because you can, you know, tune your material, craft it as you want, and maybe achieve something useful at the device level. But also, you may end up a bit frustrated and say, OK, this is just a device. Can I go to the system? Can I do something with these devices? OK. And so this is the question I would like to address here. So can we use all these novel functionalities to develop neuromorphic systems? One of the limitations is that in most academic labs, we cannot build networks with 100 million of neurons and synapses. So you have to ask yourself, OK, I have these interesting devices. I'm going to try to put them together, but what am I going to learn? Okay, so I think here it's important to have a scientific question and try to answer it. So it's like when you do physics, you often have a toy model. Here you could try to be a toy system, right? That would be the idea. Try to build a toy neuromorphic system. But then you need to, you know, to have an idea that you want to check and some concept. So, there are many physical phenomena that we could use for computing that are interesting to pursue and try to show that they could be useful for computing. So for example, we have many stochastic devices, and noise is often a problem in Boolean computing. Can we use it for neuromorphic computing? As I told you, neurons and synapses are highly stochastic and noisy. Here, what you show, what you can see, so this is a spike of a neuron. You see the function of time. And here, you have it's the same neuron that responds 50 times to the same input. And you see that it's not completely random, but it's very noisy. Okay. What you see here is, so when you have a synapse, the ions go through the membrane through ionic channels, and these channels regulate the current through the membrane, so regulate the behavior of the synapse. And here is what the current through a channel looks like when it's open. It's, in fact, always switching. It has this telegraphic switching. So it's very, very noisy. So all these devices are very noisy, but they are inside our brains. And they are working. I mean, they do something interesting. So it means that we should be able to compute with devices that have this kind of behavior. And I mean, we have many of these devices in nanoscience. And in addition, it could be interesting because maybe we could reduce the power consumption in that way. So for example, in spintronics, we have these devices that have two ferromagnets, right? And in between, for a ferromagnetic layer for the magnetization to switch, you have a given energy barrier, okay? And the higher this energy barrier, and the more current you need to switch it when you want to go to 0, to 1, okay? But at the same time, when you want to make a memory, you need a high energy barrier because you want to keep the information. So we are used to, in this field, to work with junctions that are extremely stable and so that require a lot of current to drive. But it's a way to think, but when you want to do neuromorphic computing, do you need a retention time of 10 years for computing? Not necessarily. So in fact, if we would allow more stochasticity to the device, if it didn't matter, if sometimes it just switched due to thermal fluctuation, maybe we could gain a lot of power. And this is what you see here, is how the current that you need to switch scales down with the energy barrier and with the junction diameter. And so here, where you need very, very little current to control the to switch the element. In fact, you see that you can get to a situation where the magnetization by itself fluctuates. So you get the same behavior as the ionic channels. And what is interesting is that you can still, in this regime where it's still completely stochastic, you can still tune the rate of switching. And so we could potentially use this for computing. So, but how could we compute with this kind of device? I mean, they are low energy, okay, they do something, but then they are very, very stochastic. So how could we compute with that? It's a good question. There is a world field that is called stochastic computing that tries to take advantage of this behavior for computing. So one way to do it is to say, okay, my nano device is not very good, so I'm going to try to cope with it. So for example, it's not reliable, but if I sample it many times and average, I will get something reliable in the end. So for example, here, I would sample a lot, and even if instantaneously it's random, the mean frequency is stable. So the mean frequency, I can work with it. That's a possibility. Another way to do it is to say, okay, each device is not reliable, but if I take an ensemble of devices and I replace one device, I use redundancy to compute with an assembly of stochastic devices, maybe I can use their properties. And in fact, it has been shown in neuroscience that if you do what they call population coding, you can have more than the sum of your stochastic device if you take an ensemble. You can compute smartly with them. So we are exploring these kind of ideas. And also, there are some behaviors in biology and in physics that show that in some conditions for highly nonlinear devices, noise can help you for some purpose. So it's extremely rare, but for sometimes noise can help you. So for example, there is a phenomenon that is called stochastic resonance that shows that noise can help to detect a weak signal. So here, for example, this is an image. It's a grayscale image, and we took the image, okay, and we put a threshold. We put a threshold, and below the threshold, the pixels are shown as below the threshold are shown as black, and above are shown as white. Okay, this is a saturated picture. And now we take again we keep the same threshold, okay, but we are going to add some noise to the image. So usually when you add some noise, you deteriorate the result. But here, you see that adding noise to your image is going to improve the result because actually you are going to add noise and you are going to help the pixels that needed just a little bit of something to go over the threshold to indeed reach the threshold. And so you can reveal the image. And this occurs in a range of noise. Of course, when you put too much noise, then the image is bad again. But you see that noise can help. And this has been shown to be a mechanism that is used widely in nature. It is observed in neurons. Probably it's useful in the brain. It could be useful for computing with nano devices, but there are no algorithms that I know that take advantage of this. So this remains to be invented. Okay, it's for you. It's for you to do it. All right. So stochasticity is interesting. Something else that would be interesting to use is nonlinear dynamics. The brain is dynamical. Neuron spike. They are some kind of oscillators. They have their internal frequency. They are connected by synapses, which are also dynamical. All this system interacts and has some inner dynamics. So the brain, there is no resting state. It's always active. When you are sleeping or doing different kind of activities, you have all these oscillations in the brain that result from the activity of all the neurons. And there are many, many different frequency bands that you can record in the brain that correspond to different states of attention and activity. Okay, and so probably it's useful for something. And okay, I'm going to skip that. But the idea is to say, okay, in artificial neural networks today, the neurons are static. And so, but in the brain, they are dynamical. They integrate the spikes that come to them. Then when the spikes reach a threshold, the neuron is spiking. And so this frequency, as a function of the frequency of the input, has this activation, this nonlinear shape, but in fact it is spiking. So the question that we can ask ourselves is it useful? If we were to give this kind of behavior to our neurons, hardware neurons, could we compute more efficiently? Let's say, could with the same size of a system, could we do more? Can we confer some functionalities to our neural networks? It's an open question. What is sure is that this nonlinear dynamical behavior that neurons have and assemblies of neurons display have, of course, fascinated physicists. And so many of them have developed models that are based on this nonlinear dynamics for computing. And so some people propose to use the transient dynamics of neurons, the way they change all the time for computing. Other people propose to use the fact that they can go to different attractor states depending on the inputs for computing. So you can think to use all these models in hardware for achieving some pattern recognition, for example. And I'm going to talk about this tomorrow with spintronics, but there are people that also try to do that with memory stores. They show, for example, that if you have two CMOS neurons that emit spikes and that are connected through memory stores, this CMOS, the spikes of these CMOS neurons can modify the because the memory store is going to receive spikes, it's going to change its resistance. So it's going to change the way the two neurons interact. And so it can lead to mutual synchronization. And this can be used as a process for pattern recognition. And I will discuss that more tomorrow. And then I have just time to come to the final thing I wanted to tell you. Is the spike. We have talked about stochasticity, we have talked about oscillation, but can we use spike for computing? And here I will develop a little bit more. So there is a learning rule. A learning rule is the way a synapse is modified that has been observed in the brain in vitro, in vivo, that is very robust, and that is a local learning rule that could be very interesting to use in hardware. So this learning rule is called spike timing dependent plasticity. So what does it mean? So you have two neurons, a pre-neuron and a post-neuron, right? They are connected in that way by the synapse. And what measurements have shown is that the way a synapses evolve depends on the timing of the spikes of this pre and post neuron. There seems to be some kind of causality. If the pre neuron in blue spikes first, and then the post neuron spikes, okay, it looks like there is some kind of causality. It seems that this synapse has been involved in the transmission of this information, okay, and in that case, it has been measured that indeed, when the pre-neuron spikes first and the post spikes after, the synaptic change, the synapse is reinforced. On the contrary, if the pre-neuron spikes after the post-neuron, it's the opposite. It has been observed that synapses are depressed. Okay, so there seems to be some causality in the way synapses evolve, and this is called spike timing dependent plasticity. And you see that what is interesting is that it's a local learning rule. The synapse evolves according to the spikes that of these two neurons, of the neurons that it connects. It doesn't depend on the other layers or it doesn't do backprop. It just evolves, like in biology, due to the neurons. And what is nice is that we can do that with memory stores. We can achieve this exact learning rule with memory stores. How does it work? The idea is very simple, is to play with the pulse shape of that is applied, the spiking shape of the neurons. So you have the two neurons, and imagine you have this kind of voltage, emit these voltages like that, okay? And here you have the memory store in between. So the voltage across the memory store is the difference between this and this, okay? And what you do is that you choose this amplitude so that when you have only one spike, the maximum voltage that is applied here is below the threshold for the memory store. So a single spike is not going to modify the conductance. But if the two spikes occur close to each other, they are going to overlap, and their difference can be over the threshold and modify the conductance of the memory store. And what you see here on this sketch is that depending on the timing of the pulses, of the spiking, you can have a positive voltage across the memory store or a negative voltage. So depending on the timing, you are going to increase or decrease the resistance. And in that way, you can implement spike timing dependent plasticity. And so this has been measured in real devices. So for example, here, it was silver and silicon memory stores. And you see this is a synaptic change as a function of the timing of the pulses. And there are other ways to implement very similar behavior using more of the physics of the devices, but I don't have time to explain here. And so this is nice, first, because we can do something like biology, but here we can do more. Because, in fact, and I will try to explain, thanks to this mechanism, you can do unsupervised learning. So there are two things that you can do. You see that it's great because this time you don't need an external circuit to change the value of the memory store. It's just due to the spikes of the memory store. So there is no need for an operator to change the value. And in addition, there is not even need of a teacher because it can do unsupervised learning. So unsupervised learning means that it can find by itself correlations in the inputs that you send. Okay? So for example, it has been shown that a neural network with STDP, you can feed it with these video streams where there are cars on a highway on different lanes, and this network is going to be able by itself to understand that there are lanes, and it's going to be by itself counting the number of cars that pass in each lane. So how does it work? So I'm going to try to explain you. So imagine, so you have this crossbar of memory stores. So these are the electrodes. For example, the top electrodes. Here are the bottom electrodes. So at each of these points here, you have a memory store. And these are the input neurons. And these are the output neurons. Okay. So at the beginning, all these memory stores have nano devices. So they are a bit random. So they are not all similar. And so you are going to send a first input. So for example, you have the MNIST database, so you have the handwritten digits. You send a 3, okay? So these are the different pixels. And let's say a 3 is going to result in these neurons here spiking, right? So it spikes, it's going to go through all the memory stores, because the currents are going to pass through all these different electrodes. Okay, and then this is going to, because, for example, here, just by chance, in this particular electrode, this memory store was a bit lower resistance, this one and this one. Somehow, just by chance, it is this current that is going to be the biggest and is going to result into this spiking. Well, because of that, you have the pre-neuron spiking, then the post-neuron spiking. So these memory stores that have contributed to the occurrence of these spikes are going to get reinforced. Their conductance is going to be increased. And on the contrary, the ones that didn't contribute are going to be weakened. So their resistance is going to increase. Okay? So you see that you reinforce what has been useful. So next time you show a 3, oops, it doesn't work. But next time you show a 3, these ones will be even more reinforced. And so this special neuron is going to specialize into 3s. Okay? And what you do is that you put some inhibition between these neurons so that they don't learn all the same thing. And so like that, when you show one, it's the other neuron that is going to learn ones, etc. You do like that. And in that way, it's a kind of reinforcement, and they are going to learn in that way. And so what is nice is that this Okay, so just to be clear, so what happens is that at the end, so you show your data, and each of the output neuron is going to specialize to different digits. But it's just going to, what happens is that it's going to spike according to different digits, and then it's, it just has clustered information. Then after, you need a human to say, okay, this neuron codes the one, this neuron codes the three, because it's a bit random, right? So you,
I don't really see it, how the spikes in these three orange neurons are, why in these neurons they are synced better than the other neurons? Because the point is that the spikes are timed well, right?
Yes, so what happened is that here you have pre, then post. So you have the causality, so through STDP you increase their conductivity.
Yes.
Through the overlap of pulses.
I don't understand what.
So what, sorry, I probably don't understand your question.
Maybe I don't understand the question either. I will ask again after.
Okay, you sure? Because.
Yeah, I think a little more about that.
Okay, okay. No, but if you, it's not clear, tell me, because it's okay, sorry. Sorry if I was not clear. But yes, the idea is that they get more and more reinforced. And so what is nice is that this, what it has been shown in this paper is that this can work even if the synapses, the devices here are very nonlinear, very noisy. It's very robust to device imperfections. So it's really cool, and very recently it has been shown in hardware in these two papers here. So this was done for example, this paper, this is what is shown here. They have done a very, very small neural network with titanium dioxide memory stores, and they can learn very simple things. But you have a question.
Yeah, in this architecture you showed with the square, like, yes. Is it true that every memory store has like multiple inputs and multiple outputs here? Because
so this, each little green thing is a memory store.
Yeah,
and all these memory stores, they are, so for example, all of these are going to be sensitive to this input voltage. All of these to this one, okay?
Yeah.
And then they are all going to be sensitive. I mean, they are all resistors, so there will be different currents created through these different vertical lines. But only the currents that are strong enough can overgo the threshold of this neuron and make it spike.
So like in terms of input and output, is it like every memristor, every green dot, is it like an input and an output? And
yeah.
Can you put like arrows in the lines?
Yes, so it does. It's the inter. Yeah, it connects this neuron, this memristor connects this neuron to this neuron.
It's all two inputs and two outputs.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Okay, and so it's very nice, it's promising, because it's biologically inspired, it allows unsupervised learning, but it's not yet as good as backprop. For two reasons, it's not very well known how to stack these layers to make a deep network like that. And also, even if you make a deep network like that, you see it's just a local rule. So these memory stores or these synapses evolve according to the local activity of the network, of the neurons. And you don't have this mechanism of precise credit assignment to the error that is at the end of the, to the global error. It reacts locally. It doesn't have a vision of the error. And that's why it's not as good as a backpropagation that really modifies each weight depending on the global error of the network. Yes?
Maybe missing something. So the fact that a specific memory gets the higher signal is just dependent by the weight, practically. So how do you select which one is getting the highest?
Okay, so at the beginning, you don't select anything. It's by chance.
Okay.
So, but then it's by chance, but those that are, for example, you see here you put a 3. You put a 3 would correspond to pulses here, okay? And just by chance, by luck or by random, at the beginning, these 3 here, these 3 memory stores were conducting better than this one, this one, this one, or better than this one, this one, this one. So the current flow through this line, by chance, was stronger than in the other line. And this induced a spike here. because it went over the threshold of the neuron. And when this neuron did spike, you had a causality between the input and the output for these memory stores. And these, through STDP, got reinforced. And the other ones, through STDP, got depressed. And so you see next time, now they are very conductive at this branch. So it's next time you present a three will be tend to be characterized by having inputs at these lines. And they will even make the memory store more and more conductive. And so each time they get reinforced. And, yeah.
Can actually be, for example, 3 and 4 have the same?
Yes, so it happens. So that's why you kind of, as soon as one is spiking, you, because these red things here signify that you prevent the other ones to spike.
Okay.
Yeah.
What if none of them spike?
If none of them spikes, that's bad. So you need to change the threshold of your of the neuron so that something happens. Yes. Or you need to put more inputs or stronger inputs. Or,
so yeah. I think I almost understand, but these purple dots in between,
yes,
they are also part of the current path, right?
Yes.
So from the top dot, let's say, to
yes,
the output, shouldn't all these purple dots also be reinforced?
No, because so that's where it's a bit tricky. I did not explain well, but here you have causality because you have a pre that goes for a post, and here it's nothing creating a post, and so through you need a STDP, you design a STDP that is going to depress them. When you
because the current, like you said, I mean the current goes this way, I would say then.
Yes, but here you STDP is causality, so STDP means. If you have a pre-neuron that spike and then a post-neuron that spike, you reinforce. So this is what you do here. But here you had no spike. And still you had a spike at the output. So these ones, they did not contribute. So they are depressed. Yeah. So that's how it works. But it's very nice, but so there is a lot of work to do from the algorithm point of view to try to understand how to make this efficient, to get very nice classification with this. And in hardware, it has to be implemented through large scale. It has never been done. Okay, so I think we are at the end of this talk, so I'm going to skip that. And I'm going to go to my conclusion for you. So, yes, well, so what I wanted to say, so I'm going to try to be clear. So, we've been computing using two ingredients, semiconductor physics for our computer processors that are based on semiconductor physics and the laws of electricity for implementing Boolean logic, okay? So this is what we have been doing. But now, for neuromorphic computing, we are getting away from Boolean logic. So the question is this still the best way of computing, or can we use other kind of physics for computing? So for example, can we use, I don't know, gravity for computing? Can we try to use other physical phenomena? So for example, if you use gravity, you can classify marbles that fall through this kind of automaton. So this can be a way of computing. What I'm trying to say is the following. People in neuroscience and physicists have been inspired by physics for computing. For example, Hopfield has proposed something that is called Hopfield networks that is going to use the fact that if you have an energy landscape with many local minima, you can use this local minima to store information, and you can perform pattern recognition by having all these attractors correspond to some input image, okay? And so these concepts, I don't have really time to explain, but they are inspired from physics at the origin, but then they've been transformed into neural networks, losing the original layout. And then they've been run on a computer using binary logic, okay? And all this was inspired from physics and inspired from spin systems, for example, lattice of spin systems. And this dates back from the 70s. And at that time, it was not possible. We didn't have the means. We had only bulk materials. We couldn't imagine to have nanotechnology that would allow to have spins connecting together, interacting, and controlling this. So now this is the question. Why don't we go back to the physical original system, try to make it, and maybe it would be more efficient? So, for example, I said the brain is critical. So why don't we use phase change devices for computing, and even more widely, why don't we try to use physical phase changes in systems to compute, to try to go to the result of a computation. The brain is dynamical, so why don't we try to use oscillating devices? And even further, why don't we use attractors or transient dynamics for computing with these devices? Or the brain is noisy, so why don't we use stochastic devices and try to leverage the probabilistic behavior of ensembles of these devices for computing? So, I mean, there is a lot to do and to imagine, and this is for you to do if you're interested. Okay. Thank you.